familiar passage of scripture, and it's an unfamiliar way that the Lord delivered this to me. So I pray that if you pray while I'll preach while you pray. We will hear what thus says the Lord. Amen. Isaiah chapter 6. In reading at verse number 1. And I'm going to read today. I know that's surprising from the King James Version, just because there's a simple word in there that will help us with the message today. Isaiah chapter 6, verse 1. When you have it, say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Word of God reads this way. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw also the Lord. You may be seated. That's enough right there. The year that King Uzziah died, watch this. He said, I saw Uzziah die, but that ain't all I saw. There it is, Brother Nate. I saw that Uzziah died, but I also, somebody gonna catch that in a second. I saw when Uzziah died, that was bad, but I also
saw the Lord.
Goes on to say he was sitting on his throne and he was high and lifted up, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Above it stood seraphims. Each one had six wings. Two wings they covered their face, and two wings covered his feet, and with two wings they did fly. And one cried to the other and said, Holy, somebody should have caught that in your spirit, Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The earth, the whole earth, is full of his glory. Somebody read the Bible. I'm so glad to be in a Bible reading church. Y'all help me out. Lift up your Bibles all over the sanctuary if you would. Leather bound, vinyl, electronic, whatever you have, repeat after me. I am. Because it says I am. I can. Because it says I can. I will. Because it says I will. Thanks be to God. New life. Let's go to work. As I keep living in this mean, cruel world, and it's mean, isn't it? From day to day, from week to week, from month to month, and year to year, I don't know about you, but I need to come to the house of the Lord and hear some good news. Anybody, don't leave me by myself now. I need to get up in the morning and come to the house of the Lord and hear God speak to my... Anybody need God to speak to your situation? You got one or two issues going on that you need the Lord to speak to in your situation. I need to get up and make my way to the house of the Lord and hear God speak to my mishaps and hear God speak to my misfortune, my missteps. I need to come to the house of the Lord and hear a song. That will get me through. Do you hear anything today that's going to get you through next week? I just need one or two songs. That said, I'm so glad, and this is on my list. We've been talking about it, Brother Walter, but thank you so much. I'm so glad that trouble don't last always. I needed to hear that this morning. Anybody got trouble other than me? And sometimes you just need to know this stuff ain't going to always be. It won't always be like this, and I'm so glad that trouble doesn't last always. I need to hear somebody pray that weeping may endure for a night, but joy shall come in the morning. I need to hear a preacher say that God is good and he's good all the time. I need to hear something from the God of another chance.
Amen.
Notice I didn't say the God of a second chance, because if you're anything like me, I ran out of second chances a long time. Let me help you. Your first sin should have killed you. So let me back up and get you. I ran out of second chances a long, and some of y'all older than me, a long, long time. So he's a God of another chance. I need to hear musicians play. I need thee. Every hour, anybody other than me, oh Lord, I need thee. I need to know that somebody, my grandmama used to say it like this, I'm on the battlefield. Y'all remember that song for the Lord. As we walk into today's text, we can see that Isaiah, I just read it in your hearing. Isaiah said, there was a time in my life, just like some of us, he said, where I said, things are not looking good in my life. Isaiah is saying, as I went on my way, things are not looking so good. But then Isaiah says, as I went into the temple, he says, I had a moment with God. Watch this, don't miss it. Isaiah said, I remember it like it was yesterday.
In fact, Isaiah remembered it so well that he said, I need to put a tag on this. And so he opens up in chapter 6 by saying, I remember when it was. It was that year that King Uzziah died. Now, if you just look at that on the surface, that might not mean anything to you, but let me back up and get you. You know, your pastor's already done the work. He said he remembers it because not only was King Uzziah his king, King Uzziah was his friend. And he said, I remember the year that my friend died. He put a label on it and he gave it a title. I remember because it was the year that my friend died. So let me do this so you don't think that I'm just talking about Isaiah. Can you remember the year that mama died? Some of y'all can do that. In the year that your sister died, in the year that your son died, in the year that your brother, your best friend, your spouse. So this would have been you. And in that year, can you think about it? I know that was the year that they passed away, but that ain't all that Isaiah said. He said, I went into the house of the Lord and King Uzziah had died. He said, I saw that, but I also. You just need to write that down and take it with you. It's spelled A-L-S-O. He said, I remember when King Uzziah died. But that ain't all I saw. When I got to the house of the Lord, he said, I also. Let me help you. You get excited when bad things happen in your life and you recognize them, but then you say, but I also saw the Lord. So Isaiah said, I saw that bad stuff happening in my life, but I couldn't focus on the bad stuff. He said, in the middle of all of the bad stuff, I also looked over and saw the Lord. That'll bless you on your way home. When you see something bad, it'll shout you when you think that not only do you see all the bad stuff, but you also see the Lord. I've lost my spouse. I can't possibly continue in this life, in this world. I've been saved a long time, but now I can't go on, Pastor, because she's deceased. Life has a way of bringing us to our knees. The loss of a soulmate can cause you to question God, can cause you to question life, to ask questions like, what is this all about? Can you imagine? So think about that year. That year that tragedy gripped your family. That year and how it made you feel and how you reacted and how you thought, Lord, I can't go any further. Before I go there, I just want to make sure, I just need to pull the house. Anybody ever felt like that? Now, this is not for, if you super saved and sanctified and you more saved than Jesus, this message is not for you. But for the real folk, you ever been in a place where you said, Lord, I can't go not another step. I can't go. Lord, if you don't do it, it won't get done. Lord, I can't help myself. It's messed up. My life is a mess. My life is in shambles. Right? I'm talking to Christians now, because real Christians say, Lord, my life is in shambles, and if you don't fix it, it won't get fixed. Okay, so to y'all, you've been in that place where you say, Lord, I can't do this no more. If you don't fix it. So Isaiah said, I see that, but I also saw the Lord. And so when we get to the place where we feel like we can't make it, we can't do anything else, and Isaiah said, I remember it because it was the year that King Uzziah died. That was the year of my pain. Isaiah said, the year of my grief, my sorrow, my disappointment. Isaiah said, it was the year that my friend, my mentor, my confidant. Isaiah said, I remember it well because it was the year that King Uzziah died. And he said, I went to the temple. Now the temple doesn't seem like much, but Isaiah, let me help you in the 21st century vernacular. Isaiah said, wherever I was, it didn't feel right. I was at my mama's house and I couldn't get no relief. I still felt the pain. I was at my friend's house and I still felt the disappointment. I was at my own house and I still couldn't get no relief. But there's something about getting to the church house. If I can just get in the presence of God, I got a feeling and a sneaky suspicion that everything is going to be all right. So let me just help you. I'm not talking about the church building. If you can't make it to the church building, you ought to still be able to get in the presence of the Lord. Isn't that right? Grandmama used to say, get quiet and get yourself somewhere and sit down so that you can get in the presence of the Lord. So I'm not just talking about the building of the church, but if I could just get in the presence of the Lord, Isaiah said, I saw all that other stuff, but I also saw the Lord. But look at the text. Look at the text. Look at the text. He said, I saw something else. I also saw the Lord. So watch this. When you come into the presence of God, you ought not just see your issues. When you go to New Life on Sunday morning, you ought not just see your issues. You ought not just see your problems. You ought not just see your pain. But when we come to the sanctuary or in the presence of God, wherever you are, you should not just see your disappointment for the week or voice your disagreements with life. But when you come into the presence of God, we, like Isaiah ought to say, I see all of my problems. I know you came to New Life, but y'all, did you bring your problems today? Because I brought mine. Everywhere you go, there is trouble. Isn't that right? So I probably, but you ought not just see your problems. You ought to see the Lord. You know how you can see the Lord. Just look back over your life. All right, some of y'all got the R&B songwriter said, some of y'all got, it was Betty Wright. Y'all know Betty Wright. You ain't been that same. She said, some of y'all got to go back a little bit further than others. Isn't that right? When you look back over your life, can you see the hand of God? Oh, come on now. You ought to think it. When you can see the hand, you know where he brought you from. You know what he did. You couldn't have done it by yourself. You wouldn't have made it by yourself. So you ought to thank God that he brought you safely thus far. But Isaiah is saying, you ought not just bring your problems. We should not just come to church and watch this. You ought not just come to church to criticize everybody or to judge everybody. Or to condemn everybody to hell except you and your little ugly wife. You should not just come to church and gossip all morning long. You should not just come to church to check it off your to-do list. You went to church this week, but we should come to the church to see God and to also see the Lord. Isaiah said in the year that King Uzziah died, my friend, my loved one, my homeboy died. It was in that year that while I was hurting, I was still dealing with death. And while I was still in pain and while I was still wrestling with the woes of death, he said I was dealing with the fact that not only had my friend died, not only had my friend passed away, not only had I lost my loved one, but he said I also lost the king. But then I saw the Lord. Well, watch this. Isaiah said, when I got to the church, I saw that the king was dead. I saw that Uzziah was dead. But when I walked into the temple, I went to church, I got in the presence of God, and then I remembered that although the earthly king was dead, the King of Kings is still, come on, you see it already, the King of Kings is still dead alive. See, sometimes we put our trust in the pastor. You better be careful, right? Because you might show up one day and the pastor's going to be dead. Don't you fool yourself, but I'm on my way to glory. Don't you worry about me. But just in case you show up and the pastor is no more, you better put your trust in the man, in God who can save you. You better put your trust in somebody that when you see his face, you'll be able to say amen. Don't you put your trust in man, because I'm here to tell you, man will let you down. Man will disappoint you. Man ain't gonna always come through. Man ain't gonna always have your back. Man ain't gonna always give you your $20 back. But there is somebody, and his name is Jesus. And the songwriter said it like this: you ought to put all of your trust in him. And when you put your trust in Jesus, I promise you, you will never be disappointed. So Isaiah said, when I got to the temple, I saw that Uzziah was dead. The king was dead. But when I got there, I saw that the King of Kings was still yet alive. See, a church ought to encourage you. Amen. If you go to a church that does not encourage you, I suggest you ought not go to that church. But the church ought to encourage you. The church should make you feel better, make you live better, make you think better. The Bible says that Isaiah said, when I got to the church, I saw the King of Kings alive and well. So whatever your issue is today, this afternoon, at New Life, whatever your problem is when you showed up this morning, whatever your burdens are that you brought with you, listen, you came to the right place. Because I came to tell you that the God I serve, the God you serve, the God that we serve, is an able God. He's well able. The Bible says that he's able to do exceeding and abundantly above all that we, come on, you know the word, that's what it says. So don't be ashamed today if you brought your problems with you. They have a way of following you, because I brought mine too. I know you're hurting. I know that you're in some pain. You have some disappointment. So can we see the movement of the text? Well, watch this. We welcome or walk into the house of the Lord and get into the presence of God. We ought to also see the Lord and not just our problems. I'm going to unpack this and I'm going to take my seat. Now, I know you see your issues. I know that you see your problems. But in the middle of your problems, can you also see the Lord? Let me help you see the Lord in the middle of your problems. The only reason you didn't die in your problems, it was the Lord. The only reason you didn't die in your sickness, it was the Lord. The only reason you didn't take your own self life, it was the Lord. The only reason you didn't kill somebody else for messing with your children, it was the Lord. The only reason you didn't commit, as my my grandmama used to say, the only reason you didn't commit the homicide is because it was the Lord. So in the middle of your problems, that's how you see that it's also, I saw the Lord. Well, that excited me because I realized that in the middle of all my pain and my heartache and my grief, God is not walking around heaven trying to figure out what to do next. Watch this. The Bible says not only did Isaiah said, I got to the temple and I saw the Lord. And he said, when I saw the Lord, he was sitting on his throne. Security is coming down. I want to show you this. He said, when I got to the temple, he was sitting on his throne. I'm waiting for security. I know they can hear me. They somewhere. Where they? Here they come. Here they come. They come in running. They come in running because we're on a time schedule. Here he comes. Oh, he ain't running, but he walking fast. Come on, bro. I need it. So when he got to the temple, the Bible says, not only did I see the Lord, but when I got to the temple, let me help you out. He said, when I got there, I saw the Lord. He was high and lifted up. But what's important is that he was sitting. Don't miss it, Miss Prince. Help me preach today. He was sitting on his throne. Now that might not mean much to you, but let me help you in the middle of your problems. You ought to get excited that he's sitting on the throne. You know why? That means he ain't walking around heaven scratching his head, trying to figure out what to do next. That means he ain't walking around heaven trying to figure out how your problem came into existence. You ought to do better than that. He ain't walking around heaven saying, I don't know what's going to happen tomorrow morning. I don't know how you're going to get this next $5 of gas. I don't know how you're going to get this next promotion. I don't know how all your children going to get home. I don't know how your bank account is going to swell up. I don't know how your cancer is going to go away. I don't know how your marriage is going to be healed. I don't know how you're going to deal with your uncle passing away. I don't know how. God ain't walking around. The Bible said, and when I saw him, he's sitting on his throne. You know why that ought to bless you? Because in the position of seating, that means he's in complete control. So while we down here going through all kinds of hell, God is seated on his throne. And he ain't anything like me or like you. He might just cross his legs. Because he's God. He ain't got nothing to worry about. So if he ain't worried, why you worry? If he's got tomorrow in the palm of his hand, what you worried about? The Bible says that not only did I see the Lord when I got to the crib, but when I got to the temple, he was seated. I'm going to stay there till you get it. He was seated on his throne. So let me say it to you again. He ain't walking the streets of gold trying to figure out how to help you. He's not walking the streets of gold trying to figure it out. A songwriter said it like this. Why are you trying to figure it out? God is already. Okay, why are you trying to work it out? God is already. I'm going to say it again. Why are you trying to work it out? God is already. God is done. You know why? He is seated. Oh, you ought to do it. He is seated on his throne. In other words, God ain't worried about nothing. He's got tomorrow in control. He's got February already figured out. He's got December already done. He's got November already laid out for you. He's got 2020 already hooked up. He got the presidency already filled. He got the Oompa Loompa out of the White House. You ought to thank God in advance because he's seated on the throne. He is in complete control. If God ain't worried about it, then you too. Oh, not worry about it. Come on. The Bible says that he is seated on his throne. He is in complete control. So let me help you. Let me do it like this. We ought to get somewhere and sit down. If God's got it, you ought to sit down and let God do what God does. You ought to sit down because God knows. You ought to sit down because God sees it all. You ought to sit down because watch the movement of the text. Not only is he seated, but the Bible says that he's high. Come on, don't leave me now. He's high and lifted up. Oh, bless God. That's it right there. I'm glad that the Bible says that he was seated. But I'm really glad that the Bible says that he was high and lifted up. You know why it's good that he's high and lifted up? Because he can see your problems from a different vantage point. Somebody on Facebook, that's just a favor. Thank you. He can see your problems from a different vantage point. In other words, we see our problems from ground zero. They right here in front of us, right? But when God is high and lifted up, he sees stuff around the corner you can't see. He sees stuff down the street that you can't see. He sees stuff next month that you can't see. So I'm glad that he's high and lifted up. Watch this. In verse number 2, the Bible says that he's high and lifted up. But also up there are some seraphims. And each one of them had 6 wings. You see that? They said two to cover their face. Y'all see that it's in your Bible. It's in there if you didn't tear it out. It's in your Bible. He had two to cover their face and two to cover their feet. And with the other two, they flew around. So watch this. In the original language, in this order, to be high and lifted up, one had to be raised or elevated. Okay, let me back up and get the slow folks like me. One has to be raised or elevated. So look here. In this passage, he's saying that in order for God to be high and lifted up, somebody had to raise him. Don't miss it. Somebody had to lift him. Oh, I forgot to tell you, but I wanted to wait till we got right here. The title of today's message is Help Me Lift Jesus. Okay, I knew that would get you, so let's do it together. The title of today's message is Help Me Lift Jesus. So here it is. He's high and lifted up. But you know me. You know me. I try to be studious when I'm studying for Sunday morning. I said, well, how did he get high and lifted up? What happened that he got high and lifted up? I understand that he's high and lifted up, Isaiah. But how he get high and lifted up? What took place, Chris? That he got high and Jermaine? What happened that he got high? Because however he got high and lifted up, I ought to join the ring. So I'm trying, how did God get, some of y'all already see it, how did he get high and lifted up? And then I could hear my grandmama at Solomon Baptist Church when we would walk to church across the field. And by the time I got there, the shoes that I polished with Vaseline, because that's what she made me do. But by the time we got to church, I said, Grandmama, it didn't make no sense because now they dusty again. And she would make me wipe them off like this. Right, so they'd be shining when we got in the church. But I remember over there at Solomon Baptist Church in Odessa, Texas, I'm trying to figure out, they had a song that said, Help me. Y'all know the same song. Y'all have the same grandmama. I love that. Help me lift Jesus. So I'm looking at this pastor's scripture. I'm trying to figure out, how did he get high and lifted up? But watch this. The Bible says that the seraphims cried, Holy. Don't miss it. They cried, Holy. Holy, holy. So I saw that, but at first glance, it didn't make sense to me. But then, as I read further and I studied the original, I found out that that's how he got lifted up. Because they said something to lift Jesus. That's when I thought about that song, and I said, somebody help me lift Jesus. So here it is, 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 here it is. Good God Almighty. And then I'm going to take my seat. The more you lift up, the less time you got to think about your problems. Some of y'all got it already. The more you lift up Jesus, the less time you got to think about all your haters. The more you lift up Jesus, the less time you got to walk the floor at night. The more you lift up Jesus, you'll have fewer questions. The more you lift up Jesus, you won't be focused on your issues. The more you lift up Jesus, the fewer attention you will give to your situations. The Bible says that the seraphims cried one to another to lift him up. And so watch this. If you study the original, in order to lift somebody up, really what they said is you've got to hoist. H-O-I-S-T. Like this. Y'all missed it. That's the best I got. I'm old. That's how you lift up. Some of y'all gonna catch it in a minute. Yeah, you got to hoist it. You almost there. You got to lift up. There it is. Y'all catch it now. I see you, Brother Arthur. You got to. Y'all make me work too hard. This is a rope whisper, but you got to. You got to lift up Jesus. So let's do it this way. You ought to get him high and lift it up. Because when you get him high and lifted up, how then, Pastor, do we do that? We're not the seraphims. We're not the angels. How then do we lift him up? Let me help you. The way you get him high and lifted up is you got to hoist him. You got to hoist him up. So we ain't just going to walk around doing that. That ain't going to make sense. Folks going to think we're crazier than we already are, right? I know you happy in Jesus, but you can't go to work talking about somebody gonna get you. So I got a remedy for that. I got a remedy. If you want to lift up Jesus, when he does something for you, you ought to just say amen. If you want to lift up Jesus, and you want to hoist him up, then you ought to say thank you, Jesus. The way you hoist him is you just use your words. Taleo, we teach the kids at the daycare, you ought to use your words. Isn't that right? We don't allow any whining. You got to use your words. So let me help you out. You ought to use your words. If you want to see God bless you, then you ought to act like he's done something for you, right? So when God blesses you, and you want to hoist him up because you want to help me lift Jesus, I want to see how many folks are going to help me lift Jesus. Think about what he did for you last week. No, no, you got to use your words. Use your words. Use your words. What did he do for you last week? So if you're going to lift up Jesus, you got to say, thank you, Jesus. If you want to hoist him up, you got to say, Lord, I love you. If you want to hoist him up, you got to say, hallelujah. If you want to hoist him up, you got to say, he is the King of Kings. Come on, let me help you better. If he's made a way out of nowhere, that's not for everybody. If you know you couldn't do it, but God did it for you, you ought to lift up Jesus. How do I lift up Jesus? I got to use my words. What is my word this week? Well, he saved my soul. Thank you, Jesus. That's how you lift him up. He saved my family. So how do you lift him up? Thank you, Jesus. So we're just going to practice. Just say whatever you feel. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Lord, I bless you. My heart, come on, when I get to yours, you ought to thank you. My hallelujah belongs to you. Lift up the name of Jesus. Come hell or high water, lift up. Come on, you ought to hoist him up. If you want Monday to be better, you ought to lift up. Come on, you got to lift up Jesus. Use your hands better. You ought to lift up. Gee, if he's done anything for you, you ought to lift up. You got to hoist him up. You got to do what the seraphim did. Every time the seraphim cried holy, they thought about something else. So the Bible says if we get to heaven, we ain't going to have nothing to do but praise him all day. You know why? Because every time I get up, I think about something else the Lord has done for me. And I go back down on the ground and cry, holy, holy, holy. And then I stand up and I think about something else the Lord has done for me. I go back down to the ground and I cry, holy, holy, holy. So here it is. I want you to get three things in your head. Come on, get three things in your head that the Lord has done for you. And when you get them in your head, you figure out with your own self now, how I'm going to hoist up Jesus. He's been good to me. So I got to lift up Jesus. So lift up Jesus however you want to lift up Jesus. I see you, ushers. You ought to wave your hand to lift up Jesus. You ought to open up your mouth to lift up Jesus. You got to hoist him up. So whatever he's done for you, your praise ought to match his blessing. Your praise ought to match what he's done for you. Your praise ought to be good for a good God. Your praise ought to be gooder than your blessing. Your thank you, Jesus, ought to be gooder than his deliverance. Your hallelujah belongs to him. And you owe God a hallelujah. So on our way out, won't you just help me? Come on, help me lift Jesus. Say it like my grandma would say, just help me. Lift Jesus. Now everybody, lift different. There you go. Just throw it up there. So when you get to work tomorrow and everybody's on your nerves, aren't you? Just walk around the office and... Yeah, when you get to work on Wednesday, Chris, and all the clients is getting on your nerves, just leave the studio and just help me lift up Jesus. When you're doing a plumbing job next week and somebody gets on your nerves, just lift up Jesus. Let me help you better. When you're at home, Sister Talay, and all the children and your husband getting on your nerves, just go find you a quiet space and just lift up Jesus. You driving down the street and everybody cutting you off, don't use both hands, just use one hand and lift up Jesus. Come on, you ought to help me lift up Jesus. If he's done anything for you, you ought to tell God, thank you. That's how we hoist Jesus. That's how we lift up Jesus. Just use your words and say thank you. Let me help you better. The Bible says that the redeemed of the Lord ought to say so. I said it to you before, you ought not clap so, you ought not stomp so, you ought not dance so, but the Bible says, let the redeemed of the Lord. So you ought to open up your mouth and tell God thank you. Come on, you ought to open up your mouth and let God use you. You ought to lift him up above your tears. Come on, just lift him up above your pain. Lift him up above your disappointment. Lift him up above your sleepless nights. Lift him up above your work issues and your home issues and your illness. Lift him up above your grief. Somebody, anybody, help me lift Jesus. Help me lift Jesus. Help me lift Jesus. Somebody on this side, come on, help me. Help me lift Jesus. Come on, I need one or two folks here to help me. Come on, help me lift the Savior of the world. Help me lift the one that shed his blood for you. Help me lift. Okay, how about in this second? Somebody in the middle second. Just, okay, I see you. Just help me.
Jesus.